Good evening, everyone. In accordance with the provisions of the Open Public Act, the Asbury Park Board of Education has provided adequate notice of this meeting by sending a notice of the time, date, location, and the exact known the agenda of this meeting to the Asbury Park Press, the New Coaster, on January 14, 2022 via email. Copies of this notice has been placed at the Administrative Building, Bulletin Board, District Schools, Asbury Park Municipal Building, Asbury Park Police Department, and filed with the City Clerk on January 14, 2022. Our mission statement. So Asbury Park District will provide all students with a comprehensive and progressive education where everyone possesses the skills and character to succeed in a diverse, evolving global society. Roll call, please, Mr. Hastings.
Ms. Halls, Ms. Breach,
Chair.
Mr. Grillo,
here.
Mr. LaRocca,
here.
Mr. Remy, Ms. Ricks,
here.
Mr. Saunders, Ms. Lozinski,
here.
Ms. Cook.
Oh, sorry. Flag salute, please. We're going to start with our committee reports. Dominic, please.
Thank you. Finance Committee met. The first thing we talked about was beginning to work on the 2023 budget. You may have seen where the governor has moved his annual budget address to March 8th rather than, I believe it would have been this week. We haven't received guidance on our expected funding levels, but this just, we will 48 hours after the governor's speech. So this just again will reduce the amount of time we have to work on the budget. In discussing the budget, just to recap, we have some new board members and those in the audience. The state uses a formula to determine what a school district's budget should be, and they use a formula to determine what the municipality's portion of that budget should be. And we are currently dealing with the consequences of a bill that was passed a few years ago, S2, which under the formula is reducing our budget. Our budget will be reduced approximately 6.8 million for the academic year 2023. So in effect, we've been, as we're doing that, we're addressing it through budget cuts, and we're dealing with the fact that the state funding formula currently assumes Asbury Park would be paying $23 million towards our budget. We are currently paying $13 million. So the committee, as we have been doing, as we've been doing cuts over the past few years, also looking at increased revenue from the city over the past few years, we're recommending a $2 million increase to go from $13 million to $15 million toward the school budget for 2023. We also discussed the action by the state legislature. They're looking at developing a school funding formula evaluation task force. We as a committee were unanimous that we'd like to see transparency. The formulas used are not completely open to the public, and that seems like a fundamental step for every school district to at least understand or be able to respond to how the formula is deriving both the school district's budget and what the city should be paying toward that budget. Second item was the legislative audit follow-up. Administration has responded. We expect that at least half of the remaining items will be found to be completely compliant, and there might be some minor steps that we take with a few others. With regard to our annual audit, the state's extending the deadline till March 15th, and the auditors, the accountants that we've hired, expect to provide the final audit document in about the next 10 days. Item number four, you'll see on the agenda, or hopefully you have seen on the agenda, there are three different bid proposals. This is the significant amount of ESSER funding of the federal funding that we've received, primarily because of the pandemic, and much of it going toward facility issues, and that will ensure the health of students and staff, HVAC projects, things of that nature. Fifth item, the administration has been contacted by the owners of the 910 Fourth Avenue building regarding the possible sale of that property. We do have a right of first refusal for any potential purchase, but the plan is that administration can find options within the school district to house those that are currently working at the central office as we move forward. And we'll keep you up to date on those developments. And then finally, just some great news, and I feel like I'm going to get the name wrong, but on behalf of George and Anna Zuchnowitz, I can do the Italian. The district received notification of a donation of $25,000 towards scholarships for our students. We should have a resolution thanking them. I think if some aren't able to, well, we're following up with the attorney to see who might be a contact. If some can't make it, I'd be happy to go along and personally thank any family members that are involved, and would just make the suggestion, it'd be great if we could let our community know we've had that kind of support, and thank these graduates of Asbury Park High School who have since passed away, but leave a legacy here for us. And that concludes the report.
Thank you. Ms. Ricks?
Thank you. I'll get used to that sooner or later. The CNI committee did meet on 2/14, and we had a very brief meeting. Number one is Thurgood Marshall had the opportunity to collaborate with Duke University Consortium and the University of Arizona's Center for Middle Eastern Studies. Our kids will be able to have a virtual meeting with the kids and discuss animal extinction in Europe, not in Europe, I'm sorry, Egypt and Gaza at no cost to the district, which I think is very important. We also discussed the Dream Academy through Brookdale Community College. The hours have changed on Thursdays for an additional hour, and we are recommending that we pay the chaperone of that program for an additional hour every Thursday through March 5th. And we also discuss the trips as listed. We also recommend that those trips be improved. Mr. Ruiz, did I miss anything?
We do have one agenda item, so I'll have Ms. Dr. Howard just talk about it a little bit.
Good evening, everyone. The item that I'm asking to be voted on is called the SLE program. It's a structured learning experience. A lot of us may have known it as the old CIE program where students, almost like a work-study program. What has to happen is you have to have teachers who are certified in several courses, including wage, labor laws, and things like that, in order for them to be able to go out to the wherever the student is going to be working and allow them to, you know, have the, give them a plan. They have to provide a plan as to what they're going to be learning. And the reason why I did this is because, unfortunately, after COVID, a lot of our students worked during COVID. So a lot of them didn't come back. And their issue is that they have to work. So some of our students, they will have the required courses without having to take the electives. They can just take an SLE program and they can work and make money. And then some of them, even if they don't want to work and make money, they can actually go on site and get other learning experiences and jobs that they perhaps may be interested in. So I'm asking that the cost is in here, number 13. It's a minimal cost for each teacher that has to take the course. And we're asking that we have at least five staff members. They don't necessarily have to be CTE teachers. They can be English teachers. They can be guidance counselors. They can be any staff member that has a certificate. And we're asking that we get this on this board meeting because there's four courses that have to be taken. And I would like to get it done before June so we can start the program in September. Any questions?
And just for clarification, it was not that students did not come back. They opted when we were virtual to remain virtual so that it did not conflict with their work schedules. So that way they could take classes, complete classes, as well as work. So it wasn't that students did not return. They opted to stay fully virtual.
Thank you, Dr.
A question, do they get credit toward graduation with the program if you go over
yes,
that?
Yes, they do. So I'll be working with Mr. Ruiz so that we can have a correct curriculum so that they will get credits.
Thank you.
And the courses will be in the course description and there'll be codes for them. It's very similar to work study, which was done in the like early 80s and 90s, where students worked in a co-op program half day, went to school in a half day, completed their graduation requirements, and then the additional graduation requirements were fulfilled through the work study or the co-op program that they found towards the students in that time.
Thank you, everyone. Mr. Grillo.
Thank you, Madam President. So Buildings and Grounds met February 17th at 6, and a couple of items to report out. One is we've agreed to let the A7FL use the football field for the spring football events that they're gonna have. They've agreed to pay the fees for use, and they'll also pay to provide police officers to attend the games to kind of make sure that everything stays okay. And the fee is approximately $15,000. I thought I remember hearing it be $18,000, but I guess Jeff could give us the exact price on that. And then with the security grant that we have, the Securing Our Children's Future School Security Grant, we've ordered 60 cameras associated with that grant. And however, as with a lot of things, they're currently on back order, supply chain issues and whatnot. But we expect receipt and of the cameras and installation to begin in late March. And this will be an upgrade to all the buildings to the same online access format, which is Genetech Security. As far as the three ESSER bid proposals, the three resolutions are gonna be on the agenda. And It allows the architect to update the long-range facility plan. And this ties into the HVAC projects to be completed under the ESSER grants. Fourth item is stadium repairs. So the administration met with the new architect to review the proposed stage one repairs that were developed under the former architect. And we plan to start stage one repairs this spring. And two contractors have been contacted and they've provided us with quotes. And then the other thing that we spoke about was, I think it was Ms. Breach that brought it up, was the placing of a plaque at Barack Obama Field to acknowledge the donation of the trees that we received. And we wanted to discuss that with the full board to see what that would look like and how we could do that in a cost-effective way. Yep. And that's it.
I just wanted to say that there won't be any cost to the district as far as the plaque. It's going to be coming out of the foundation. So we drive.
Ms. Halls?
Good evening, everyone. The policy meeting was held on February 17th as well. We have a list of new and revised policies that come from Strauss Esmang. I'm going to read out the policy and just a synopsis of each of the policies. Policy 2415.05, student surveys, analysis, evaluations, examinations, testing, or treatment. Excuse me, which was a revision. It addresses the issue of a school district administering a survey, analysis, evaluation, examination, testing, or treatment funded in whole or in part by a program of the United States Education, Department of Education. It was rewritten to provide additional detail regarding the requirements outlined in the federal code and regulations codes. School districts must receive prior written consent from the parents. Next, PNR 2431.4, prevention and treatment of sports-related concussions and head injuries. This is a revision which expanded the scope of the law to include intramural sports along with interscholastic sports and cheerleading programs. Strauss Esme addressed these revisions by modifying the definition of athletic competition used in the policy guide. Next, we have policy 2451, which states adult high schools, a revision, additional code section titled individuals with disabilities at NJAC 6A22.4 was added and one section was removed titled monitoring, which was previously codified. To keep it short, revisions to terminology, adults to students, individual and limited English proficient adults to English language learners. Revision 2460.30, additional compensatory special education and related services. This new statute applies to students with disabilities who exceed or will exceed the current age of eligibility. This new statute does not guarantee all students exceeding the age of eligibility will receive additional or compensatory services. Rather, the statute makes it clear that it is the role of the student's IEP team to determine if the student requires such services. Policy 2622, student assessment. We have both a revised and a new. The superintendent is now required to report only the final results of the annual assessments to the Board of Education and to the members of the public. The revised policy guide shall replace a school district existing policy 2622. Policy and regulation guides 2622 are mandated and must be adopted by the board. Policy 3233, political activities. This is a revision. Revise the term Board of Chosen Freeholders to Board of County Commissioners, and freeholder and chosen freeholder shall be county commissioner. Policy 5460, high school graduation, which is a revision. The revision provides greater clarity regarding the graduation assessment requirements for the classes of 2023, 2024, and 2025, and updates to the high school diploma criteria for out-of-school individuals. A new optional section has been added to the policy guide 5460 for school districts who choose to participate in the optional section. New Jersey Department of Education, state seal of biliteracy program. Policy 5541, anti-hazing. It is a new policy. The new law requires public and non-public high school and middle schools to adopt a anti-hazing policy. The revised criminal law provides an updated definition of hazing, and Strauss-Esme recommends hazing claims to be investigated using the same procedures used for student code of conduct violations. Policy 7540, joint use of facilities. It is a revision. The term Board of Chosen Freeholders to Board of County Commissioners, and freeholders and chosen freeholders shall be county commissioners. Well, I feel like I just read that. Both policy and revision, bias crimes and bias-related acts. Guides have been updated to align with NJAC and the Uniform State Memorandum of Agreements between Education and Law Enforcement Officials. Addendum titled Responding to Hate Acts and Bias-Related Acts, Gender Identity or Expression, and national origin or has been added to the protected class of individuals. School property has been revised to school grounds. And then we have policy 9560, administration of school policy. School survey, which is a revision. The new law and revisions to policy guide 5960 include a process for notification of parents and an outline of the topics that may be asked, addressed anonymous and voluntarily. Also with policy 9560, Strauss-Esme believes it will be less confusing if policy 2415.05 addresses the federal rule and the policy guide 9560 addresses the state rule, which is mandated. Also, number two policy, I think this is the same thing, 540 athletic awards. The committee discussed the need for a regulation to go with the athletic awards policy to establish a standard across all sports. The committee will follow up with Strauss-Esme to see if they already have a regulation, as well as checking with other districts. 2.2, the committee also discussed parental involvement and how best to increase community participation in district events. The committee will discuss with the full board. Anything else?
Thank you. Okay, before I open up the public meeting, the public participation, I have a little statement for you.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I forgot about that. I'm sorry, Connie.
The athletic committee met on the 16th of February. We spoke about developing some type of regulation policy, working with the administration for the athlete of the year, both male and female. That won't be just including sports, but hopefully also include the scholastic ability and their community involvement. The MLK is going to have a middle school, upper middle school. We're going to be doing track relays at the high school. We're not able to do it for the high school because we don't have certain events available at the high school, but the middle school is going to start, I think this spring, we're going to have relays at the high school. And let's see, the boys basketball team made the playoffs this year. The first game is going to be March 1st at 8 a.m. at Brick Memorial. I think they're playing Perth Amboy, but yes, they made the playoffs, so mark that date down. The fall sports schedule, they were attached to our minutes, so if anybody has any questions about that. And our homecoming this year will be October 7th. It's our last home game, so it's a little bit later than this past year, but at least we have some more time to get ready, and hopefully we'll be able to have our parade this year, so we can mark that date down. And also, starting the fall, we are going to have a boys volleyball club, much like we started with the girls a couple years ago, and now they made varsity. We're trying again with the boys, and that'll start this fall as a club, and hopefully go to the varsity level next year, 2 years.
Thank you. Okay, so the club of participation, I'm going to have a statement read by our lawyer.
Good evening, everyone. In accordance with Board Policy 0167, the Asbury Park Board of Education recognizes the value of public comment on educational issues and other matters of importance, and provides members of the public with the opportunity to express themselves on school matters of community interest. The public comment portion of the meeting is not a question and answer session, and all public comments shall be directed to the board president or the presiding officer of the meeting. Members of the public who wish to make public comments must be recognized by the presiding officer and provide his or her name, municipality of residence, and group affiliation if applicable. All public comments shall be directed to the presiding officer and are limited to 3 minutes in duration. Members of the public who do not follow the foregoing rules and/or interfere with the orderly operation of the board meeting may be removed from the meeting.
Thank you. It is now open.
Good evening. My name is Mrs. LaShawn Anderson Bray. I am the mother of John A.J. Bray as well as her advocate. I'm going to give you a little background on where John A.J. comes from. I graduated from Brookdale. Wasn't supposed to. It says for rising above all obstacles and challenges and achieving your college degree. When I started Brookdale, I was homeless. When I finished Brookdale, I had just had John Asia. I was pregnant going to Brookdale. And when I had John Asia, my friends, when they finished their classes, they would watch my daughter while I went to my classes. I have a certificate for Association of Nursing, a certification of appreciation again from Brookdale, board member of EOF, certificate from Thurgood when I worked there, also appreciation. On top of, I'm a veteran. I wasn't supposed to make it. My mother had me at the age of 15. I'm from Long Branch, where the teachers were nurturing and they cared. Now let me tell you about John Asia. John Asia, yeah, she's autistic. And we see the world differently. She doesn't have an intellectual disadvantage or anything holding her back. It has to do with stimulation and nurturing. I push my daughter to be out there. At the age of 3, my daughter's IQ level is 116. You can't learn that. That's in her DNA. my daughter, and the 101 Dalmatians as Anita. I pushed her. Girl Scouts, Safety Patrol, Certificate of Achievement, Honor Code, Certificate of Achievement, Perfect Attendance, Honor Roll, More Honor Roll, Honor Roll, Fourth Grade Honored by Your Fraternity. Autistic. And you want to give her an IEP. Because what does autism mean to you? Is it an intellectual thing? Or is it because you're closed-minded and you can't see differently? Because we live in a different world. We see colors. We don't wake up in February and celebrate Black History Month. Unfortunately, we wake up every day Black. I teach my daughter every day. You teach her Black History Month of everything about being injustice, and that's not equal. Yesterday is history.
Thank you, Ms. Thank Price.
You.
Anyone else? At this time, I will close public participation. We're going to review the agendas.
I can start with mine. That's fine. Business agenda starts on page C1. I'd like to bring to the board's attention, as was noted in our committee minutes from the Finance Committee and Mr. Lataraca, on C2 you'll see the scholarship award, the acceptance of the scholarship from the Zuchnowitz Memorial Scholarship. There was also the adoption of the security grant. This is a resolution we previously adopted, but the state has asked us to readopt the resolution along with some other districts based on the timing window. I would also note the long-range facility updates, which we referenced earlier on page C4. Those are updates to our long-range plan that allow us to move forward with various HVAC projects that may not have been originally included in the long-range facility plan that was submitted, I believe, last year. I'd be happy to take any questions from board members on any of those topics. Thank you.
Good evening. Items for tonight's discussion are, we'll start the Saturday academies at our schools. We have the staff appointed for recommendation for appointing staff school assignments and transfers, as well as the recommendation for the strength and conditioning position, as well as retirement and dealing with other items related to policy, which are up here, updated provisions, and as well as the CNI items, which were discussed by the board members under the CNI committee. At this point, I'll entertain any questions related to the agenda items, which are on B1 through B5. Yes, sir.
Are we fully staffed now for the Saturday preparatory academies, or are we looking for any additional?
No, we have the staff members now. That's what kind of led to the delay. Initially, the planning was done properly, the advertising, it was just really waiting to fill those positions with the staff that were willing to work those number of Saturdays.
Because that'll be a great addition. Thank you.
Any other questions? One of the other items that I did want to mention that was in the weekly superintendent's update to the board members was a survey that we completed, student survey that we completed over the last week and a half with 824 student responses, which really gave us an opportunity to galvanize the direction of our district. As you know, we're going to be student-centered. As you can probably see, some of the participating families that are here this evening of our student, one of the pieces of that is our student advisory committee, which we're going to recognize this evening during the 7 o'clock hour. We're going to do the work that has been identified in that student survey with 825 students responding and participating in that. And the results, I hope you had an opportunity to review it, are actually outstanding. They give us a real window as to the level of student advocacy and efficacy that we want to build here in the district. And I'll be looking forward to working with the Student Advisory Committee over the next several months as we implement and begin to plan out our school uniform initiative, as well as looking at a number of areas that have been identified as growth opportunities, as well as successful opportunities that we have here in the district. So if you have not had an opportunity to do that, I would please recommend that you review that survey. So this evening, we have a couple of presentations. We have our Student of the Month presentation. We also have our, again, Student Advisory Committee recognition, as well as our monthly school presentation for Black History Month being done by the Bradley Elementary School. So I'm just trying to look into the audience and see if all of our students of the month are here, but I don't see all of the administrators. I think we have one that's not here. Thurgood Marshall, I see Dr. Jackson. Bradley, I know Ms. Jackson Byers is here. Dr. Howard Morris is here, and I will probably stand in for Mr. Medina. So are all of our students of the month present? Anthony Cruz Cortez, is Anthony here? Okay, no, just trying to take it. Let's see. Eric Lopez. Is Eric Lopez present? Okay. Murray. First name Zagala. Zagala Murphy from MLK. And I know Diamond Jules Harris is here. Hey, Diamond. I want to, you know, if we can hold off to all of our students are here to do that during the 7 o'clock hour, because that was the time in which we told them. Our students from the Student Advisory Committee here, if you can raise your hand, see a few of them. And again, I had advised 7 p.m. for that. So, you know, I want to give them adequate time and stick to that time frame.
Can we make a motion to close until 7?
Yep, I'm the second.
All right, move it.
Motion to adjourn?
That's what the...
Oh.
And I seconded it.
All in favor? Okay. Everyone, we are adjourning the 6 o'clock meeting. We will come back at 7. Please hold tight. Hello, good evening, everyone. We're going to start our 7 o'clock session. Okay, in accordance with the provisions of the Open Public Meeting Act, the Asbury Park Board of Education has provided adequate notice of this meeting by sending notice of the time, date, location, and extent known, the agenda of this meeting to the Asbury Park Press and the New Coaster on January 14, 2022 via email. Copies of this notice has been placed at the administration building, bulletin board, district schools, Asbury Park Municipal Building, Asbury Park Police Department, and filed with the city clerk on January 14, 2022. Our mission statement, Asbury Park District will provide all students with a comprehensive and progressive education where everyone possesses the skills and character to succeed in a diverse and evolving global society. Roll call, please.
Ms. Halls.
Here.
Ms. Breach. Mr. Grillo?
Here.
Mr. LaRocca?
Here.
Mr. Remy?
Here.
Ms. Ricks? Mr. Saunders?
Here.
Ms. Lozinski? Here. Ms. Cook?
Here. Please rise for the flag salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Dr. Adams.
Good evening, everyone. Madam President, thank you also for recognizing the change in the agenda. Presentations will be moving to 6 o'clock moving forward, so that way students can get home and get back to their regular routine and start for the next school day. So first of all, I want to thank all of the families that came out this evening in recognition for a couple of things that we have going on. First thing I would like to do is recognize the young lady in the back who did the decorations behind us. Her name is escaping me right now. Kira. Miss Kira, if you raise your hand so you can be recognized. Thank you very much. As we've been doing for the last several months, Student of the Month recognition, if we can have the principal from Bradley Elementary School, Ms. Jackson Byers, come up, and student Eric Lopez.
Good evening, Board of Education, parents, teachers, and friends. It is an honor and privilege to introduce the Bradley Elementary School nominee for the month of February 2022. We have third grade student Eric Lopez. We are proud to say that this young man has really embraced being a role model. He has consistently displays a variety of leadership skills. Eric is always willing and eager to lend a helping hand to his peers and offer encouraging words. When working in a team or in a small group, Eric will oftentimes be the one that will motivate his team to be focused and stay on task. Eric has excellent class participation, brings good insight to group discussions. Eric is hardworking and continues to be motivated to present to be his best. His teachers have expressed that Eric is a pleasure to work with, and to see him continue to evolve in a role, a pleasure to work with him. Congratulations, Eric Lopez, Bradley Elementary School, February 22, student of the month. And as always, Eric, We have a couple things. You always have to walk away some Bradley Elementary School gear, right? And Mom, we just want to say thank you because of you. Thank you for blessing us with Eric, and this is for you. Thank you. And we want, when you go out, you say, what school does my child go to? Bradley Elementary School. That's where it is. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jackson Byers. We'll have Dr. Howard Morris come up with high school student Diamond Jules Harris.
Good evening. In addition to being a director of student services, I happen to be the acting principal at the high school. So I just got the had the pleasure of meeting Diamond this week, but before Ms. Baumgartner left, she and her team chose Diamond as the student of the month. So Diamond Harris is an absolute delight as a student. She's the type of learner that all teachers wish they had more of. She is polite and pleasant to everyone. Diamond is self-motivated, completes all of her work, and goes beyond the basics of any given assignment to get the full benefit of the experience. She genuinely wants to know things and holds herself to a high standard. Her last video project for her class was one of the most all-time favorites, this is her teachers say. And she created an ad for a robot that she built. And once we get permission from Mom, we will share that video. Diamond put together a commercial in which she built a robot, she wrote a script, she dressed for the cast, and edited the final project. It was amazing to say the least. I watched it. The eighth grade team says that they will miss having her as a student next year as she transitions to the high school. We cannot wait to see what amazing things that she goes on to do with her life. Diamond Harris, thank you very much. And we will, Diamond, this is my first time doing this, so we will have something for you this week, okay?
Thank you, Dr. Howard Morris. Next, we'll have Mr. Perry Medina from MLK Upper Elementary and his student, Zakiel Murray.
excuse me, is Ziggy here? He's supposed to be. Told me he was coming. All right, Ziggy Murphy is our selection for our student of the month. And he's an exceptional young man. Like many of our students of the month for our school district, they display everything that we would hope for, everything that we would want. Ziggy is extremely intelligent, sociable, popular, but also represents the best of all of us. So I'm very honored to have Ziggy in our school. I'm grateful for his parents. And so we will accept this on his behalf and I will deliver it to him tomorrow. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you, Mr. Medina. And last but certainly not least, Dr. Jackson with her student, Anthony Cruz Cortez.
Good evening, everyone. I am so delighted to present our Student of the Month award for Thurgood Marshall Elementary School to Mr. Anthony Cruz Cortez. Anthony is a wonderful young man. His teachers, Ms. Cortez and Mr. Kelleher, describe him as a student who always tries his best in all of his classes, is always willing to help his classmates, especially in his favorite subject, math, and most importantly, is always kind to everyone in our Thurgood Marshall community. Anthony, your Thurgood family thanks you for representing our school so well. This family is very special to me as I had Anthony's older sister, Angelique. I was her kindergarten teacher. I remember Anthony when he was a little baby, and we are so proud of you. Congratulations on being our Student of the Month. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Jackson. Another part of, and we'll get let Anthony get himself situated. One of the committees that we started a couple of weeks ago was the Student Advisory Committee. So if you are a student member of the Student Advisory Committee, would you please come up? Come on. Now, these were students that we sent notification to their parents. You could just go stand straight in the middle so everybody can see. Go ahead, we have something for you. You guys can line them up. Yeah. So these are all students from the cross spectrum of our grades here. We have students from elementary school to the high school. What we're doing is Mr. Reed's gonna be passing out pens to those students, the block Asbury A. These students, over the last couple of weeks, we had did a student survey. 825 students participated in this survey. The information that we gathered from our students was not only exceptional, but also informative in making our district student-centered. The Student Advisory Committee will work on launching our uniform initiative in September, as well as making sure PBSIS is up and running, as well as ensuring that we are providing student advocacy and efficacy here in Asbury Park School District. And so for all of these students, if you haven't seen our school webpage, the first meeting was held virtual, and those students were very instrumental in not only being brave enough to ask questions, but also representing the cross-section of all of the students in our district. To give you a long-range understanding, we have students from the high school, and we have young students as low as kindergarten. In the next 12 years, that high school student will be somewhere around the age of 27, 28, 29 years old, when that kindergarten student is a senior. And so when we think about the long-range impact and the trajectory of our students participating and living in this district, their voices and the longevity of the impact that they have because they live this life every day is critically important to how we will move and improve the outcomes for the children in which we serve. And so I want to thank you. I look forward to working with you, and I look forward to all of your feedback that you have in order to help us be better and do better on behalf of the children in this district. So I wanted to recognize you and thank you. We're going to turn this over to Ms. Jackson Byers, who has the last presentation. Is it on the stage? Oh, they're going to do it over here? Okay, I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Jackson Byers.
Okay, so as you are aware, Bradley Elementary School is the place where all students are prepared for college and career readiness. We live by the saying, and a child shall lead them. Black History Month is American history. We had our Black History Month program today, and tonight we have a collaboration between our Mrs. Rice Schwartz's kindergarten class and Mrs. Nicholson's third grade class, and it's titled Rhythm, Rhymes, and Funky Good Times. So please, if you feel the need to get up and get with us, please do it. We invite you to do it. Give them a round of applause as they come.
Thank you.
Thank you. How you feel, brother?
Feeling good.
You feel good?
Feeling good. It's
been so much bone, brother.
Yeah.
How you feel, man?
I feel all right.
I call your name. I don't want no people to know you're in here. How you feel, brother?
Right.
Yeah, yeah. Sure getting down. Look at him. Ha. We're gonna have.
Madam President, that concludes my presentation.
Good job.
Encore.
Can I say, I feel really bad whoever has to follow up that presentation.
Could we just have the names of the teachers who participated in that once again to acknowledge them?
Yes. The names of the teachers, Ms. Jackson Byers, come to the microphone. The grade and the teachers, please.
That was a collaboration with our kindergarten class, Mrs. Wright Swartz's kindergarten class, and Ms. Nicholson's third grade class.
Thank you, everyone. All the parents and children, if you want to leave, you guys up to leave. Welcome. Thank you, everyone. Before we open up the public participation, we are going to have a statement from our lawyer.
Good evening, everyone. In accordance with Board Policy 0167, the Asbury Park Board of Education recognizes the value of public comment on educational issues and other matters of importance and provides members of the public with the opportunity to express themselves on school matters of community interest. The public comment portion of the meeting is not a question and answer session, and all public comments shall be directed to the board president or the presiding officer of the meeting. Members of the public who wish to make public comments must be recognized by the presiding officer and provide his or her name, municipality of residence, and group affiliation if applicable. All public comments shall be directed to the presiding officer and are limited to 3 minutes in duration. Members of the public who do not follow the foregoing rules and or interfere with the orderly operation of the board meeting may be removed from the meeting.
Public participation is now open.
Good evening. My name is Mrs. LaShawn Anderson Bray. I'm John Asia Bray's mother, advocate. As I was sitting there, I noticed some things may be small to you all, but I guess maybe I'm autistic too. As I look around the board, I see that you all can't even be in solidarity with your mask on. Look at yourselves. Okay? I also noticed as the teachers or whoever were speaking and honoring the children, I only really seen Mr. Medina not reading from the paper. So does that mean that everybody else was lazy, or they really don't know the children, or I noticed that while I was sitting there. Did you notice? You didn't notice because you're looking at me like you're confused, but I know you can't answer questions. Also, I noticed that I'm gonna start talking in the second half or something because you had a presentation. All the people came after all my good key points were out there. But I know you all got the message because I seen the puzzlement on your face of how me and my daughter see through colors, and I guess you see through black and white. I dressed up today so I could represent my daughter because, you know, any other time I know I come here with the jeans on and y'all think I'm ignorant and uneducated and I have no accolades. So I wanted to put on my Sunday best too and talk about my accolades. Also, you know that my daughter, she was Google verified at the age of 5. I'm 43. Google don't even know me. That's all I want to tell you.
Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Beverly Lyons. I'm a resident here of Asbury Park, and I stand before you with my heart filled. I am so happy to see representation of the youth with the Board of Education. I know we have times that we have questions, we don't understand. Let me speak for myself. There are a lot of times I don't understand, so I do come and ask questions, and you do answer. But this tonight, to me, I believe has impacted our district beyond words that could be expressed. Thank you for that consideration. Thank you so much. And I'm believing that the transparency of your concern and love for this district, these young souls will be stirred to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Bill Butler. I live in Asbury Park. I have just moved back to Asbury Park. I really want to congratulate everybody here with the kids in terms of the joy and the celebration that they gave us tonight. In 2018 and 2019, I was the chairman of the Mental Health Board. I'm 67 years old now, and for the last 7 years, I've worked at Wegmans Food Markets. And for the last 50 years of my life, a half century, I've had a mental illness. And for 41 of those years, I've been able to advocate for people who, like myself, have had a mental illness and successfully come to the other side. My main concern tonight, from what I've heard from Neptune City when I talked to the councilwoman there who also works at Wegmans, is that with COVID and everything, there are children who might have suicidal ideation, might have tried to kill themselves, and I'm just wondering if we have the counselors, or we're going to get the counselors together in the school district to make sure that our children are not suffering, their parents are not suffering, the families are not suffering. And I'm not saying this in a threatening way. I'm saying this as someone who I've had to overcome suicidal ideation 3 times in my life, each one worse than the one before. But I've been able to come back, to be here, and I really do thank the joy and the celebration of this community. I think Asbury Park is coming back, that it will come back, and I hope that when I spoke with Reverend Lee, that we'll see a rejuvenation in the west side, that there'll be stores and additions to the condominiums, and that we'll have laundromats and things like that, so that it will be a whole community and not just for a select few.
Thank you. At this time, I'm going to close public participation.
Madam President, point of personal privilege. Sir, to answer your question, we've been very keenly aware of the impact of COVID on our students' mental health. Our district director of student services, Dr. Christy Howard Morris, works directly with our guidance counselors. We ensure that we send out our students, our guidance counselors to professional development regularly. We have a bunch going out in the next couple of weeks for trainings to help support our students because COVID has had a dramatic impact on not only the academic, but the social emotional dealings of our students over the past 18 months and before. As you know, it's a silent issue within many communities of color in terms of mental health. I think over the last maybe 2 to 3 years, there's been a lot of breakthroughs, particularly when we start looking at a lot of our athletes like Naomi Osaka and other famous athletes who will come out very publicly and talked about their mental health and being very cautious and conscious about vocalizing that. We here have been very in the forefront in Monmouth County about our social emotional learning. We were one of the premier and first districts to really launch our social emotional programs, which a lot of districts actually utilize the staff that we trained here and went out and now utilize them as consultants. So we do take it very seriously. And that's the reason why one of the things that part of the Student Advisory Council that we'll be dealing with in terms of how do we make our district student-centered so that students feel safe here. And that was one of the primary reasons why we wanted to come back in person. So that way food insecurity leads to another level of mental worry and anguish. So those are some of the things that we as a district have taken very seriously for on behalf of our students and this community. And last but not least, we were working with the city and just had a meeting yesterday with the deputy mayor talking about other resources and services that we can provide to our students in this district. And so I just wanted to make sure I provide that information to you. But thank you for coming up and being here this evening.
Ms. Carroll, do you have a report? Can I have the acceptance of minutes?
Yes, could I have a motion for items 9 and 10, starting on page A1?
I'll move it.
Second.
Any comments or questions? This is for items 9 and 10 on A1. Ms. Lozinski?
Yes.
Ms. Breach?
Yes.
Ms. Halls?
Yes.
Mr. Grillo?
Yes.
Mr. Ladaraca? Mr. Remy?
Yes.
Ms. Ricks? Mr. Saunders? Ms. Cook? Motion carries.
Consent the agenda, please.
Good evening again. I would ask for consent agenda on all items from B1 to B5.
I'll move it.
Any discussion? Questions, comments?
Roll call.
Roll call, please.
So for all items B1 to B5, Ms. Lozinski?
Yes.
Ms. Breach?
Yes, but abstain on B1D, B2, E, and F.
Ms. Halls? Mr. Grillo?
Yes, but abstain on B2E.
Mr. Ladaraca?
No.
Mr. Remy?
Yes.
Ms. Ricks?
Microphone.
Yes, except abstaining on B7, page B4. Or number 7 on page B4.
Thank you. Mr. Saunders?
Yes.
Ms. Cook?
Yes.
All items carry.
The business agenda, please.
Thank you, Madam President. Could I have a motion for all items C1 number 1 through C6 number 1?
Move it.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
This is all items C1 through C6. Ms. Lozinski?
Yes, and everything. I'm just going to abstain from school board's conference.
Number 4?
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Grillo?
Yes on everything, abstain on C14.
Ms. Alls?
Yes.
Ms. Breach?
Yes.
Mr. LaRocca?
Yes.
Mr. Remy?
Yeah.
Ms. Ricks?
Yes.
Mr. Saunders?
Yes.
And Ms. Cook?
Yes.
Thank you. All items carry.
Mr. Hastings, did we approve the calendar? Did we do that? Was included in the beginning?
8 and 10.
Okay.
Calendar was approved on 9 and 10. The closed resolution is on C4 if you need that.
Can I have a motion to go in exec?
I'll move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
For the members of the public who are present and those who may be watching on TV, the board is going to retire into executive session to discuss matters related to personnel, contracts, labor negotiations, and labor grievances. It's expected that the board will be in executive session for approximately 45 minutes. After which time, the board will come out from executive session, return to public session, and will take action. Thank you.
Can I please have a motion to open up the public session, please? Thank you.
First.
Can we just do a roll call?
Roll call, please.
Ms. Alls? Ms. Breach?
Here.
Mr. Grillo?
Here.
Mr. LaRocca?
Here.
Mr. Remy?
Here.
Mr. Ricks?
Here.
Mr. Saunders?
Here.
Ms. Lozinski?
Here.
Ms. Cook?
Here.
Thank you.
All righty, can I? Would anyone like to make a motion in regards to grievances?
I'll make a motion to deny number 1 through 5 as discussed in executive session, and a motion to grant number 6 as discussed in executive session.
So just for purposes of clarity, I think we should take, given the way the motions were made, I think we should take the one motion to deny grievances 1 through 5 as discussed in executive session. I think we should take a vote on that. And then with regard to the number 6, we should take a separate vote.
I'll amend my motion to only include 1 through 5, the denial.
Okay. This is motion to deny grievances 1 through 5. Ms. Lozinski? Mr. LaRocca?
Yeah.
Ms. Breach?
Yeah.
Mr. Grillo? Mr. Remy?
Abstain.
Ms. Ricks?
Yes.
Mr. Saunders?
Yes.
Ms. Cook?
Yes.
And I'll
motion
make a
carries.
I'll make a motion to grant grievance number 6 as discussed in the executive session.
This is to approve grievance number 6. Ms. Lozinski?
Yes.
Mr. LaRocca?
Yes.
Ms. Breach?
Yes.
Mr. Grillo?
Abstain.
Mr. Remy?
Yes.
Ms. Ricks?
Yes.
Mr. Saunders?
Yes.
Ms. Cook?
Yes.
Motion carries.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.